Claus conquers the Martians. Santa sets up a fantastic automatic toy factory on Mars. The Martian leader battles the wicked Bodar in a desperate effort to save Santa, the wise man of Mars. 900 years old. The Battle of the Toys, when Martian kids and Earth kids join Santa to battle the bad guys of Mars. For real space age fun, you'll be out of this world when Santa Claus conquers the Martians.
Oh, it was pretentious shit. To the Pope on Film. I am Bunny Williams, and with me is
Reverend Steve Galindo. I am the founder of the Church of Ed Wood, and I almost have video, and I'm dropping stuff, and yay, we have video. Yay, okay. So now we're cooking. Yes. We are in the Christmas spirit here in the Galindo household, as you can see, if you're watching this on YouTube, as you can see by my daughter Isabella. She is wearing her Christmas giant squid hat.
Who said it right here?
Her Christmas giant squid hat.
Giant squid hat. Cool.
Yeah, she won it at school.
For a fundraiser.
For a fundraiser, so...
I love it.
Yeah, she just got it. She came home just gangbusters, just, Daddy, I got a squid hat! So she's pretty excited about it.
Well, years ago, I was in Walgreens, and I had seen a frog hat.
What?
A frog hat?
I'm done. Yeah. She heard you. She's just being overdramatic.
80s rock band. Frog hat.
I gotcha.
So I had bought that for Jeannie, and she wears it every winter, and she just looks so adorable in it.
That's awesome. That is awesome. I'm going to be distracted today. I just got a replacement for my phone.
It has a sticker on it, too.
Well, yeah, no, it's the same case. Aww. That says fragile, handle with care, because that's me. I'm fragile. And you need to handle me with care. And also I damage boxes, damage phones a lot. So it's also good. You know, it's good advice. So I'm trying to get this phone set up. It's difficult. I don't remember. I don't remember everything that I had on my phone when my phone conked out. You know, yeah. What's funny, though? You know what's funny is that I get the phone set up, and I'm turning the phone on, and I'm doing all this sort of stuff. Once I turn it on,
once I turn it on and I finally have it all set up and it's in the main screen and all of that, what my phone says is, hey, Steve, you know, it's going to snow tonight, so you should be careful. It's totally going to snow. And I had forgotten about how much my phone is a liar. So the first thing I said was, oh, man, it's going to snow. Emerald, it's going to snow. And she's the one who reminded me, Dad, you remember, you know, your phone. And I'm like, oh, yeah, okay, yeah. It's just messing.
Lying sack of shit.
Yeah, my phone is the son of a bitch. Totally forgot that. Absolutely forgot that.
I have been playing a few more games on my tablet lately.
Yeah.
I'm sorry?
What sort of games?
Well, free games. So I've been playing a Walking Dead game and I've been playing a Star Wars game.
Ooh, what Star Wars game are you playing?
I am not sure. Let's get a look here. That's the wrong way. By the way, I was watching Age of Ultron and I noticed that Nick Fury has my tablet. So
really?
There's that. What is this thing called? Disney and Lucasfilm. Dun dun dun.
Is it Death Star?
Galaxy of Heroes.
Okay.
Galaxy of Heroes.
Cool, because I'm always looking for games.
And I find it really interesting and how little I actually have to play it. It's mostly just watching the fucking thing. So future game technology, I'm really looking forward to it because we won't have to play games at all.
Yeah.
That's just my prediction.
Play it for him. I gotta do what, Bella?
To check if the world has ended yet.
No, I'm not gonna check right now to see if the world has ended. I'm pretty sure that we're good, Bella.
Can I check?
Thank you, though. No.
Are we in anticipation? Have we heard something?
No. She just really likes that app I have on my phone. I'll actually do it for the camera. Is it under social? No, it's under news. Okay.
I'll just go to apps.
I've got Huffington Post. I've got Wikipedia. I've got Cracked, and then Has the World Ended Yet? It's an app right there, so I click on that, and there you go. Nope. We're still good. Check again? Yeah, check again. Nope. We're good.
What exactly is it doing?
It's checking to see if the world has ended.
By going through various news sources?
Nope, not at all. Oh. Just checking to see if, I guess, if the phone hasn't exploded in a fiery ball.
Ah, that's good.
Yeah. So that's very good. I've got a lot to talk about here in the beginning before we get to talk about the actual film. I have a lot to talk about. First off, Bella, I haven't put all of the apps on this new phone yet because I've only had it for like a small little bit. So Traxxas isn't on there. Okay.
Oh, yes.
Yeah, calm down. I'm upset because apparently the games haven't fully like updated or anything like that. I lost a majority of my pinball tables.
Oh.
I had the Addams Family and Creature from the Black Lagoon and all that. It's only registering that I've bought one, and that's Aladdin one, like Tales. What?
Regular show game.
Yes, I have that regular show ghost game. I have that on there, okay? Calm your butt down, okay? Mm-hmm. Take the sand out of your vajayjay. Episode 58 of the podcast. The last episode was really good. It was tough to keep it short. Like, I was proud of myself. And I said, I'm going to try and make this episode not a 3-hour long monster. And I didn't.
No, you didn't. And you came in Just like a little over 2 hours.
Yeah.
And then it was everything else that I needed to do that pushed it up there, including the OSI promo that somebody had mentioned today. I'm going to see if I could trim that down a bit until Mr. Lobo can get me a shorter one.
Yeah.
I mean, he even knows it's too long, you know.
Good. So. Trying to find, I had a question from I can't find it now. I had a question. Somebody asked about the, I believe it was the Santa Claus episode, that there was like a 15-minute break in the middle of the episode.
What?
Or it was John McDonnell. It was the episode before Black Christmas. So that was Santa Claus.
Yeah.
He says, what was up with that 15-minute break in the previous episode? I didn't watch I wasn't able to hear the Santa Claus episode, so.
I would only imagine that he's probably referring to the same thing, to the OSI commercial.
Okay.
The OSI commercial itself runs 11 minutes. And then there are other things in that break that I need to do, like to have me read the list or something like that.
Yeah.
You know, so
that
would come out to about 15 minutes.
Yeah. Okay. So that's probably it.
So we're working on it. That's kind of the answer to that question.
Yeah. Let me tell you something. It is getting increasingly difficult for me to keep the stance that I have about the new Star Wars movie.
Okay.
Because I love Star Wars. I love the Star Wars movies. And the internet is exploding with Star Wars right now.
Yes, it is.
Stay off the internet.
And so I really want to stay off the internet. Why don't you just tell me, hey, Steve, don't breathe. Or, hey, Steve, don't eat large amounts of sodium. It's impossible, Bella.
If you give me that phone, I can stay off the internet.
Yeah, it's because I have so many games on there.
And I would just be on the Has the World Ended app.
Yeah.
That's all I would be on.
Yeah, I'm a big fan.
Well, that's important. You got to keep tabs on that.
I do. I'm a big fan of Star Wars. I really want to see this Star Wars movie, but number one, it's impossible to get on the internet right now without everybody freaking out about Star Wars. And then even when I'm not on the internet, I'm at work, and pretty much every magazine has Star Wars on the cover.
Yeah.
Oh, hey,
every magazine, like they're really reaching for like.
Star Wars.
Homebrew magazine. We get drunk with Chewbacca and family. You know, like every magazine doesn't need a Star Wars cover.
Yeah.
So then even when you go to the store, like everything doesn't need to be a special limited edition Star Wars.
Guns and ammo. Who really shot first?
Yeah. It's getting goddamn ridiculous. I really want to see the Star Wars movie. And also just talking to people at work and stuff. So, Steve, are you excited about the Star Wars movie? Yes, I am. Do you have your tickets? No. When are you going to see it? I don't know. I don't want to see the movie with a massive theater packed with fanboys that are going to be screaming every time they see something familiar.
Yeah. Oh, no.
I want to hear dialogue. I want to hear the music. I don't want anything to distract me, including the audience.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I know. When we saw Guardians of the Galaxy for the first time, it was fairly just recently out, and during a matinee, it was fucking packed.
Yeah.
So, I mean, Star Wars is going to be like 100 times worse. I'm not even driving down the road of any of the theaters.
Yeah.
Although I do love these people posting, don't ruin Star Wars. Don't ruin Star Wars. And I just can't help. Every time I see that, I can't help jumping on the thread and just being like, they blow up the Death Star. The movie's almost 40 fucking years old.
Yeah. Yeah.
You don't know what happened. Fuck that. You know?
So there's a couple of different things I want to talk about here in the beginning. That's not really okay. Yeah, you. The point of this, Bella, is to make like a fold out paper snowflake. You've just made a brick with some symbols in the middle of it. You really need to work a little bit harder on that. Okay, C minus, Bella. I'm going to start, with, of course, the biggest news of the week. The biggest news of the week.
Yes.
Big news.
Okay.
For me and for a few other people. Not for everybody, but it's still big news. Rey Mysterio is officially in Lucha Underground Season 2.
I saw you post that. Yes.
Big news. I expected them to keep it a secret because that's kind of sort of what they did with Alberto Del Rio. He was like a 4-time WWE champion, and he was a big name when he went to Lucha Underground, and there were rumors that he was going to be there, and then just randomly at the end of an episode, like halfway into Season 1, he just appeared, and I figured that's what they would do with Rey Mysterio, because Season 1 is still, you know, Season 1 isn't coming up until... Bella, some people are listening to the podcast and not watching the podcast, so for me to try and describe this story here in the news and to have you just say "but" over and over again in the background is a bit distracting to people who are just listening. You got to think about the fans, Bella. You got to think about the fans, okay? I expected them to keep it a secret, but not at all. Just social media they just blurted it out. And Rey Mysterio and pictures of him with Robert Rodriguez. Yeah. This is a big deal. Rey Mysterio, I'd like to think, is one of the few people that kind of sort of transcend the sport of professional wrestling, in the sense that there are a lot of people who don't watch wrestling, but if you put, I think most people can probably pick out who Stone Cold Steve Austin is, who Hulk Hogan is, probably Ric Flair.
Like lay people? I don't know. I don't know if
like
if,
The Undertaker, yeah. I think. Maybe I'd like to think that Rey Mysterio is one of those people because he's just so different. He's like
casual wrestling people like myself
definitely
would know who you're talking about. You know, I don't think I think if you were asking Genie, you would get the Hulk Hogan, and that would be it.
Yeah.
You know.
Well, it's still a big deal to me.
Yeah.
It was a 3-time WWE.
Well, Rey Mysterio. I loved Rey Mysterio.
Yeah.
Rey Mysterio was always my favorite type, you know, the lightweight.
Yeah.
Always my favorite type of wrestlers. Because other than that, like regular wrestlers, that's just way too homoerotic for me.
Yeah, Vince McMahon has a real big hard-on for like massive guys that are like 6'10" and huge muscles. But the fans of WWE keep gravitating towards these people who are completely the opposite of that. But Vince McMahon still does not get it at all.
Well, like Rey Mysterio or the Hardy Boys or anything like that. When they wrestle, you just sit there and you're like, how the fuck did they just do that?
Yeah.
I would not think that is physically possible.
And Rey Mysterio specifically was in all of it. He was in ECW. And then he moved to WCW before going into WWE. So he's kind of been everywhere. And I like that.
Didn't he actually do some lucha?
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. He was a AAA wrestling champion. Yeah. AAA wrestling is a big deal. Little bit better. Kind of looks like a razor blade, Bella.
It does.
Your snowflake is a razor blade. If this were raining from the sky, people would be dead. You're a murderer.
That would be a very punk make it tree.
But still, good form. I'll give you a B minus. I also love the fact that apparently the WWE offered him some big money to return, because they don't have a lot of Mexicans right now, and they're losing like a Mexican viewers, especially because of Lucha Underground. So they're looking to get some more Latino faces, and they want a Latino star. And they offered him a bunch of money, and he turned it down flat, which is a good move for him. There's no way that Lucha Underground can be offering Rey Mysterio WWE money. But like I said before, Lucha Underground recently got into a large amount of money, so they're working on a nationwide tour and like a spin-off actual science fiction show.
Ooh.
Like to go with their mythology and also some movies. So this
and
is
what the fuck? He's got to pad out El Rey anyway.
Yeah. So. Yeah, they're doing like a marathon of all of Lucha Underground on the El Rey Network, and it's going to take like 3 days.
Yeah.
I think like 2.5 days because they did 40 hours. That's how long the first season of Lucha Underground is. So they're doing a 40 hour marathon. So about 2 days.
Nice.
Yeah. So hopefully soon they will be announcing some sort of, I'm assuming their cash windfall is related to, hopefully soon there will be an announcement as to Lucha Underground having some sort of a partnership with a streaming site like Netflix or Hulu or something like that, so that people can actually, you know, see the show. Because not a lot of people have the El Rey Network. But
I have warned Jeannie that, you know, we may be watching wrestling again if Lucha Underground pops up somewhere.
Yeah, the Onion AV Club recently, they released their, like, the top 40 shows of 2015, and Lucha Underground wasn't on there. But then immediately after they post that, because it's based on, like, a voting system and this and that, so they made a second list of which shows were you the most upset that didn't make it on the list, and someone wrote a great review about how Lucha Underground is one of the best written shows on television. Not the best wrestling show.
Right.
It's hands down the best wrestling show. But it's one of the best shows on TV. And it really is. There's a mythology and characters and plot lines and emotions beyond just seeing a bad guy show up and badmouth the town's local sports team. You know?
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
A girl looking at other people.
So hopefully then we'll be announcing a streaming partnership sometime soon. Until then, I'm just going to come out and say it. Download the shit out of that show. Like I did.
Has new season started yet?
No, it's starting at the end of January.
Okay.
End of January. Very excited about this. Very, very excited. Do you, speaking of the streaming, do you stream music, Bunny?
Not really. A little Pandora from time to time.
Yeah. Like Pandora and Spotify and all of that.
Well, just literally Pandora. I'm not a terribly musical person. I don't know why that is. I do feel hollow and empty inside because of it, but I just don't connect very well with movies. Movies, good lord. Music.
Yeah, I understood what you meant. Well, I can't stand streaming music.
Okay.
Absolutely cannot stand streaming music. Number one, my first reason is kind of a BS reason, but I know that streaming sites like Pandora and all that don't pay the artists hardly anything in terms of royalties and money like that. And I want to kind of stand up for the artists. But that's kind of my pretentious BS answer, you know? I like listening to specific artists. That's the main reason why I hate streaming sites. If I listen, if I say, hey, I want to put on a Beatles station, I want to just listen to the Beatles.
I understand, yes. Uh-huh.
And that should be simple, but that's an impossibility with streaming sites. You put on the Beatles station, you get one Beatles song, a Rolling Stones song, like a commercial for Cialis, and then the Mamas and the Papas. And it's like, how did we get from Let It Be to Everyone's Getting Fat Except for Mama Cass? I don't get that. I do not get that at all.
Cass is a girl.
Really? upsets me. And also, here's another reason why I don't like streaming music sites. I know that what I'm about to say isn't true, but it feels true.
Okay.
Emotionally feels true.
Do I look like you now?
Hi, Maxwell. How you doing? Yes, you do kind of look like me now. Maxwell looks a little bit different today because
I
washed his hair and then dried it and then combed it. These are all simple things that normal humans do.
Yes.
But
that's why it's surprising.
Maxwell's hair is usually just so wild and crazy that today I washed his hair and conditioned it, and then I washed it again with like some adult stuff. And so his hair looks great and he looks like a completely different person. He looks, forgive my saying so, Maxwell, like a normal human child.
Do you have him on camera?
Yes.
Okay. Yeah. And anybody looking at me on camera, I am folding the little slips of paper for this week's entry. That's Which what you see me doing here.
Kids, you need to find my rubber band ball. It's very relaxing for me to record the podcast while working on a rubber band ball. Yeah, you did break it. So the third reason why I don't like streaming sites, and I know that this is not true, but it feels true. It kind of like how Stephen Colbert Classic calls things truthiness. There's a truthiness to this statement, Colbert Classic. I feel that no matter what station you're on, eventually it will give you music from Jack Johnson.
Okay, guys, your boss
is
back.
Jack Johnson?
Jack Johnson, you know, like a shell necklace, and he likes to go surfing, and he plays his acoustic guitar, like beach songs to impress the ladies. I feel that no matter what station you're on, eventually it will get you to Jack Johnson. Like, I want to listen.
Ho wannabe.
Yeah. It's like, hey, I want to listen to classic rock. Oh, well, you know what music sounds like classic rock? Jack Johnson. Here's his song, Breakdown. Hey, I want to listen to the R&B and rap station. Oh, well, you know who did a duet with the Black Eyed Peas? Jack Johnson. Here's a song from Jack Johnson. And the Black Eyed Peas. I feel that even if you put in the like Norwegian death metal station on like the Pandora, then it'll be playing these heavy Norwegian death metal songs like Here's Herg de Flurg by the Derg Flurg. And now here's the song Banana Pancakes by Jack Johnson off of the Curious George soundtrack. Eventually, it all gets to Jack Johnson, and it upsets me. But anyway.
Is he the musical equivalent to Kevin Bacon?
Yeah, kind of. Kind of. But just real acoustic stuff. Now,
like possibly if we were to take Jack Johnson and put him in a nuclear accelerator and spun him around like three times faster than light, and then collided him into Julio Iglesias, we could possibly open up the doorway to the multiverse. That Jack Johnson?
Possibly. Now, one of the main things I wanted to talk about here in the beginning of the show was the sodomite police.
Daddy.
Okay.
Now,
I used to love that show.
Sodomite Police?
Yeah.
Sodomite Police.
I mostly only saw it scrambled, but it was a good show. Yeah.
So let me explain this. There's an anti-abortion, anti-gay Christian hate group called Personhood USA.
Oh, pass them on, man.
They're kind of the leaders in the personhood movement, where essentially they want to, like, Christians kind of sort of know that they can't, you know, overturn Roe versus Wade. So they're trying to get rid of abortions in other ways now.
Okay.
Now there's only like one in your state, and it has to be within like a certain amount of miles away from a hospital. And they're trying to like regulate it to death, essentially.
Right.
And Planned Parenthoods are just closing down left and right. And what these people want to do is they don't want to make abortion illegal. What they want to do is they want to give fetuses all of the rights of a human being.
Okay.
So if you get an abortion, you're tried for murder.
Right.
There.
The abortion doctor's tried for murder. They actually said it's pretty good. Yeah, that's a pretty good snowflake. It's also a bug. It's a scary bug. It's a robot bug. It's very nice. One of the things that they recently called for is that they want every woman who has ever had an abortion to go to jail.
Okay.
They recently said this. Personhood USA.
Personhood USA.
Yeah. So.
What the fuck is wrong with people?
I don't know. I don't know. But the co-founder of Personhood USA is this guy whose name is Cal Zastero. And he was at a rally in Nashville.
That sounds like a fucking supervillain.
Yeah, it sounds like it might be a Harry Potter spell.
Yeah.
Might be a Harry Potter spell. But he was at a rally in Nashville because they are trying to get Nashville to pass a bill that will cancel out the Supreme Court's rulings about gay marriage.
Right.
So while he was there, he made this speech where he said, in the near future, do you want to get the call from your child saying, Mom, Dad, the sodomite police just broke down my door and took my family away? Why didn't you stop these gays when you had the chance? Like the worst fear mongering in the world, right? Like over the top.
I want a link.
But here's the thing. I've got a link.
Send it. Oh my God. I'm going to have fun with those fucking people.
But here's the thing though. Here's the thing. What I really want to talk about is how awesome it would be if we did have the sodomite police. Talk about the positive aspects of an all-gay police force. Number one, no more police brutality. Because if we had an all-gay police force, they wouldn't say, oh, look, a black man, pow, 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 he's dead. An all-gay police force would say, oh, look, a black man, hey. Another positive aspect of an all-gay police force, they would talk anyone down from any situation. It doesn't matter if you have a gun, if you're gonna kill yourself, if you're like some sort of evil mastermind, they will talk you down. They are wonderful conversationalists and they're good listeners. They
But you gotta watch your ass if you wear white after Labor Day.
Yes. If the sodomite police are going to break your door down, it's probably going to be to, like, I want to say redecorate or something like that. But there are positive aspects.
Yeah.
Of having an all-gay police force.
Well, anything is better than the police force that we have right now.
Yes.
Can you imagine just army men coming into your house and then, like...
Wait. Come here, Bella.
We don't have to imagine, kid.
Yeah. What are you saying, Bella?
Can you just, like, imagine army men walking into your house, knocking down your door, and then, like, acting like it's a war and just painting your house?
And painting your house. Like, the police knocked down... So in your story here, the police are going to knock down your door, storm into your house and say, it's a war. We need to paint your house. Well, like what way. Color? Hmm. That's the whole story, Bella. That matters like crazy.
Red and blue paint.
Red and blue paint. Well, I don't know about that.
What colors are you like looking out for?
I don't know. This is your story. These are your police forces.
Yellow and orange.
Your jackbooted thugs that have broken into my house and painted my walls, you fascist.
Yellow and orange.
Yellow and orange? Ugh, I don't want that. Get your fruit roll-ups out of get your Fruit Loops out of my camera.
See, now I have a situation. Not really a situation, more of a curiosity.
Okay.
That I am not sure how to handle.
Okay.
So I've been sick a lot, and that's really getting on my nerves, but that's a whole different story that's really depressing. I don't want to talk about that. But that means that I spend a lot of time in Walgreens lately.
Okay.
Well, yes, because your prescription's never ready when it's supposed to be, and you wind up walking up and down the aisles being like, wow, they used to put out good magazines. What happened to that?
Oh, God, yeah.
This is a nice rubber lizard. I wish I had more money to buy this rubber lizard. So I am wandering around waiting for my prescription, and there is a girl that works at Walgreens, that I had seen, and Jeannie has seen her too. I'm not sure how to say this. This is probably not the best way of putting it. I don't know how else to put it, so I apologize. She's deformed.
Okay.
Okay. And, of course, I didn't get a really, really good look at her, because you don't want to be staring.
Yeah.
So, like, half of her face looks really kind of attractive. And the other half of her face literally looks like it has melted.
Nice.
That's what I think. And frankly, what I saw, I thought, like, that's weird, but that's really awesome looking. And you know she doesn't feel like that, you know? Or chances are good she doesn't feel like that. But at the same time, I'm also thinking, like, somebody like that might make a really excellent documentary.
Yeah, probably.
So, like, I really kind of want to talk to her, but I have no idea how to
approach
a conversation that is just that sensitive.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Hi, you're fucked up looking. I want to talk to you. You know, I mean, it doesn't seem like there is any good way.
Yeah. Yeah, I don't think there is.
You know, and then there is the added risk of you start talking to her, you're kind of thinking of doing a documentary, you start talking to her, and she turns out to be as stupid as the average American, and then you're kind of stuck. Now what do you do?
Yeah. Yeah.
You know? But at the same time, I also think somebody like that could possibly have amazing things to say and amazing insights into the human condition, you know?
Yeah. Yeah, I have no idea how you would start that conversation. You know?
I am thinking I may start it with, hey, want a Tic Tac?
Just start it light. Start it with a joke like, hey, raise your hand if you have a deformed face. Hey, put your hand down, lady.
Hey, did you ever see that Barbara Steele movie?
Is she related to Two-Face, the Batman villain?
She literally could be like a female Two-Face, like literally. It's amazing, except like her skin, the skin on that side of her face looks
okay. Go
very normal, you know, not like pussy and you know.
Yeah,
anything like that. But it just looks like it's melted. It just like hangs down, like maybe some kind of nerve damage, or you know, maybe I don't know if it was like from birth, like maybe musculature underneath did not form or something like that.
Huh. That is something.
Yeah.
Do you have pictures?
I do not. Oh, yeah. I'm having problems talking to her, man. I'm going to walk up and start snapping some pictures.
You can creep a picture out of that. That's not a... That's not a problem. So, the homework this week. Did you like the homework?
Yes, I did. Yes, I did. It was kind of two specials in one.
Yeah, yeah. We watched that last night, like me and Emerald and Natasha really liked it. They filmed it in March 2015, half in the actual hotel. That actual hotel is an actual hotel in New York, and half at the Silver Cup Studios in Queens. So it was actually that second half really was in a soundstage in Queens. I would like to think that this week's
Christmas in Heaven section is how I like to think of it.
Yeah, I'd like to think that this week's homework, a very Merry Christmas. In my mind, what it really is... a nice tight sequel to the finale of the David Letterman show. Because without David Letterman, what's Paul Schaefer doing? I'll tell you what he's doing. Following Bill Murray around anywhere, everywhere, just in case he wants to break into a song.
Uh-huh.
He wakes up at 11:45 hungover. Maybe he wants to sing a jaunty tune. Paul Schaefer is there. That's what he's doing now. With his free time.
And drinking.
Yeah. So it was. So the special was directed by Sofia Coppola.
I noticed that.
She did Lost in Translation with him. And when I see Lost in Translation, and when I see this Bill Murray Christmas special, I have to think that when you're making a movie with Bill Murray, unless your name is Wes Anderson, if you're making a movie with Bill Murray, you have to expect that a large portion of it is going to be ad-libbed.
Yeah.
Because I swear about 50% of Lost in Translation is literally just Bill Murray and a very young Black Widow getting into various adventures in Japan. I really don't think that more than 60% of that movie is scripted. That a lot of it is just Bill Murray just fucking around. Mm-hmm. So, musical director Paul Schaefer, massive cast of people.
Yes.
Apparently, he just called some people that he knew, and almost all of them said yes to the project before he even said what it was going to be or what it was about.
But, you know, some of them, you know... Some of them were kind of a reach, but then some of them, I mean, really. Was Buster Poindexter busy? Probably.
Yeah.
Not.
Yeah. I was excited to see him, though, because I don't think I've seen him since Scrooged.
And it was hard for... I kept looking. I had to break down and IMDb him. I kept looking at him, too. And I was like, I think that's Buster Poindexter.
Yeah. I had to check, too.
Yeah.
Holy crap, that is him. I like Jenny Lewis.
Which one was she?
I have a big crush on Jenny Lewis. She was a child actor. She was the redhead vague love interest
from
the 80s movie The Wizard with Fred Savage, the Nintendo video game movie.
Okay, yeah.
And I had a crush on her when I was a kid. And then she gave up on acting entirely and started doing music. And nowadays, she's a successful singer with her own band, and she has a great voice. And now she's not known as like a child star anymore, because hardly anybody remembers Fred Savage's The Wizard. But now she's known as a really good, talented musician. She sang Baby, It's Cold Outside.
Okay.
the non-rapey version of Baby It's Cold Outside. That was I liked that song because they really Bill Murray did a good job of removing the rape from that song. He made it charming and not at all rapey.
That is good.
There's
too much rape in Christmas.
Yeah. The interesting thing that I learned about this special, A Very Murray Christmas, is that everybody said yes to the project, but one of the people who said yes to the project was rapper slash mogul Rick Ross. He was going to do two songs. He was going to do one of his own songs and then some R&B Christmas song that I had never heard of called Santa Claus Wants Some Lovin'. And he was going to do that. He was going to appear at the end dressed as Santa and rap this R&B song. But he apparently couldn't get out of Atlanta. I don't know what he does with his free time. He was too busy. I don't want to say that he was wasted.
Right.
And he couldn't make it to Bill Murray's Christmas special. Maybe he was just busy polishing his Fabergé egg collection.
Yes.
But whatever happened,
he
was
supposed to be very time consuming.
Yeah. Especially if, like Rick Ross, you have a lot of Fabergé eggs. That's a lot of polishing. But there were conflicts. He couldn't be in it. So, literally at the last second, Bill Murray said, well, George, do you want to sing the song? And he's like, well, I can't sing. How about I sing the chorus? And Bill Murray said, okay, you can just pop out of a tree, you know, laughing style, well, say the chorus, and I'll sing it. Sure, I'll learn it right now. And they just kind of ad-lib that entire number.
Well, that's kind of what both me and Jeannie enjoyed about that first section, is that fucking nobody could really sing.
Yeah.
They were all they were from passable to fucking horrendous.
Yeah.
And I like that. Cuz you're just supposed to be a bunch of people in a hotel.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah.
Why should you be able to sing?
Yeah.
You know, and why shouldn't you sing if you feel like
Yeah. It was charming. I kind of choked up a little bit when Jason Schwartzman, is that his name?
The guy with the mole?
Yeah.
Yeah.
When he showed up, because it just hit me like, oh crap, he was like 17 years old when he starred in his first movie, Rushmore, with Bill freaking Murray. And now look at him, he's like 30 years old now, and Bill Murray's suddenly turning into he's got like Ric Flair hair
because
he's so old. And look at them, they're back together for this Christmas special. Like, there was a charm to it, and I really liked that.
Yeah.
But one of the things that I really want to talk about in this special has a really bad rating on IMDb.
Really?
Yeah, it's got like a 5.4 out of 10 or a 5.8 or something like that. It does not have a good rating. And I think that that's just because people are stupid.
It's really hard to argue for the intelligence of the human race these days.
I think
in any regard.
I think if the rating is bad on IMDb, and I think the reason for that is people tune in to a Bill Murray Christmas special, I think that most people, and I'm thinking like Midwest, you know, Kentucky and Poughkeepsie, that they expect the entire Christmas special to be like the second half.
Yeah.
And that's one of the things that I really liked about the special is that it starts out, this is a Christmas special that starts out with an insane level of depression.
Yeah.
But I
were always my favorite Christmas specials.
Yeah. But I just don't think that people were expecting that, and that's why the ratings are really bad for this thing. And that's a shame, because I love this special. I love this special.
I liked that Jesus had to be born in a manger, you know?
Yeah.
It was so sad. And, like, Little Drummer Boy was always one of my favorites because he was such a nasty little fuck.
I hate the Little Drummer Boy because it's unrealistic.
Yeah.
Look, a newborn baby. I know what it'll like. Me playing the drums really fucking loud.
Yeah.
That's the one thing the newborn babies like.
Uh-huh.
They love loud drum solos.
Oh, they do.
Hi, baby. How are you?
Studies have shown.
Now check this shit out. Thank you, St. Louis. We love you. Good night. Now go to sleep, baby. That's like a lullaby for children.
Yeah.
Fact.
I was never too terribly comfortable with the shepherds hanging around.
Yeah.
Because shepherds, I don't know, we paint such an innocent picture of shepherds, but shepherds are some shady fucking characters.
Have you ever seen the deleted scenes from Monty Python's Life of Brian?
I don't think so.
There's a lot more of the Judean People's Front crack suicide squad. They're like a regular character throughout the entire thing.
Oh yeah. Nice.
Yeah. But there was an opening to the movie that they didn't use. And I think that this opening that they didn't use is one of the funniest Monty Python skits they ever did. I am in love with this opening.
Yeah.
And it's like three shepherds on a mountain just talking about how much they love sheep. Except for the one shepherd who's always kind of like talking shit. Oh, they're such beautiful creatures. Yes, they are quite beautiful creatures. They can be pretty angry, though, when you're shearing them. Well, of course. See, but they're so peaceful and majestic. Oh, yes, very peaceful and majestic. Oh, yeah, well, except when you're shearing them. Why are you always on about the shearing? And they're so busy talking about how much they love sheep that they miss the star.
Okay.
Like, nice. The star appears in this beautiful music, but they're too busy staring at sheep and talking about how awesome they are that they miss the star, and eventually the star disappears. So then some other shepherds come to tell them about the star, but they think that it might be like a coyote or something, so they throw a rock at them. And they're like, ow, you hit me in the nose with a rock. Well, we're sorry. What were you doing out here anyway? Well, we've come to tell you about this amazing... Don't tell them! But they told us to tell everybody. Well, that shouldn't mean people who break my bloody nose. So they just... it's a really cute scene, and it goes on for, like, way too long. But and I imagine that it really would have, like, dragged the movie down in the beginning. But it's a wonderful opening. I'm sure it's probably on YouTube or something like that. You should totally watch it because it's absolutely wonderful.
I'm going to have to check it out. I like Brian. I don't like Brian as much as Python, as much as Holy Grail.
But yeah.
They're in the ballpark.
Yeah. Yeah. No, it's up there. So, before we get to talking about the amazing story behind this week's movie, I think maybe we should take a break. Should we take a break?
Think we should probably take a break.
We should. We will be right back with more of the Pope on Film after these commercial messages.
Action. Outer Space International is a media collective and distribution network. We're bringing you unusual, experimental, and entertaining programs from many different creative worlds. We are thinking bigger than TV. We're channeling the great pioneers of UHF, home video, and early cable. We're also taking a bit of inspiration from the space race. Like it or not, we are the future. We want you to be nostalgic about the future again. Sneak previews, trailers, special announcements, the program guide, and random nonsense will run before and after scheduled content. Our content will be viewed in television households via Roku streaming devices, Chromecast, Amazon Fire, and a growing network of affiliates on various platforms, including cable and even broadcast. You should be able to watch on your smartphones as well. You can even watch on demand. Our goal at OSI 74 is to get this content to you wherever you're hiding. We encourage our producers to own and control their own content, as well as collaborating on new content for the channel to distribute. Series producers are also granted advertising spots in the schedule to promote their projects and monetize their work. We provide support and cross-promotion to our producers to build their audience and find smart people like you with a taste for the absurd. You can help boost the channel and the individual producers by purchasing items or programs, or by supporting fundraisers of your favorite shows, and even for OSI as a whole. This is a brand new venture, and we're making new discoveries every single day. Thank you for taking this journey with us. All systems go.
Oh, hello. I'm Dr. Eric Voronoff, and I'm here to read the list of this week's drawing entries. Brock Z. Davey with one entry. Doug Nichols with one entry. Dustin Dunaway with one entry. Manic Mommy 7 with one entry. Christopher William Rose with one entry. Evogene Molodik with one entry. Beasley K83 with two entries. Ella Klaus with two entries. Julie Davey with five entries. 9 Volt DC with 12 entries. And Bruce Nobles with 22 entries. Find out the winner by watching or listening to the Pope on Film podcast. T-Puff, as they say, for some reason I don't know. And you can win the 2-DVD set of Bob's Dirty Shorts. I would wish you all good luck, but I hate you all.
And we are back
with more of the Pope on Film. You know what I've been doing lately?
What have you been doing?
I have been, every once in a while, not every time, but every once in a while, I've been eating the entire apple.
You have not eaten the entire apple before?
I mean everything, the stem and the the core and the everything.
Uh-huh.
I learned that former president Bill Clinton would eat the entire apple, and that just blew me away. So I tried it a couple of times, and now I like eating the entire apple because I love apples. I just hate having something left over that I have to eventually throw away.
Uh-huh.
That's always been the part of eating an apple that I really hated.
Yeah.
So I've been eating the entire apple. Is that weird?
I've seen people do it. It's not for me. It falls in yeah. one of those categories.
Gotcha.
But I even may have done it once or twice.
Yeah. Okay. Like, I just ate the sticker.
Uh-huh.
I just ate the sticker on the apple. So, this week's movie was inevitable. I think every movie podcast does this movie.
Yes. It's in the handbook.
Yeah. So I think it was just time for us to bite the bullet and do it. This week's movie is the legendary film Santa Claus Conquers the Martian.
Yes.
It's a gritty sci-fi masterpiece in which Santa finds himself stranded on Mars with Matt Damon.
Yes.
Which I imagine would get annoying.
A very quick. Young Matt Damon, but Matt yep. Damon nonetheless.
Hey, Matt Damon, stop vlogging. We need to figure out how to survive on Mars.
And I think he even wore the same hat with the ear flaps in Good Will Hunting.
Good Will Hunting. What a weird fluke that was.
Yeah.
I saw The Martian recently. It was a pretty good movie.
Yeah.
I liked it. It was weird because it's got this amazing comedic cast. It's got Kristen Wiig in it, and it's got Troy from Community in it. And I didn't realize it until I was watching the movie, the funny Mexican from Ant-Man.
Yes.
Is in it. It's got a hilarious cast for a sci-fi movie. I wasn't expecting that.
Yeah, I'm still having a really hard time getting over Gravity. So I haven't seen The Martian. I haven't seen Interstellar. I'm just like you fooled me, Hollywood. You fooled me good. I'm gun shy now, you know.
I haven't seen Interstellar. I own Interstellar.
Yeah.
And I haven't seen Interstellar. But I saw The Martian primarily because Kristen Wiig and Troy from Community are in it. So that was like the main reason why I watched the film. And also I learned that because Troy from Community, Donald Glover, he had given up on acting, but then they really wanted him for this one part. So he said yes, and he's in the movie. And his first scene, he wakes up and he drinks some coffee, but it's yucky coffee. He spits it in a trash can. He runs to the computer, but then he realizes something and runs to the kitchen to get more coffee. And so that's his first scene, and it was the scene that he filmed first. And on his first take, he spits the coffee into the trash can, but apparently he didn't realize that it was a wire trash can, so the coffee spilled all over the floor. So he goes and he sits on the computer, and then he realizes something, and he stands up and runs to the kitchen to get more coffee, and he falls really, really hard on his face. And then the guy who's acting with him tries to help him, and he just stands up, immediately looks directly at the camera and says, "I'm fine," and then continues on with the rest of the scene. And they said, "Cut." And Donald Glover said, "I'm sorry, guys, I'm sorry." And he said, "No, that was great. We'll probably use that." And they do. So in the Donald Glover's first scene where he falls really hard on the floor, he's actually falling really hard on the floor. Apparently, what's his name? Ridley Scott is like that. There are other scenes in his movies in which people have actually accidentally done things and hurt themselves, but he thinks it's real and keeps it in the film. So that won me over. That was one of the main reasons why I watched The Martian. And it's a funnier, more lighthearted movie than I was expecting it to be. And that's what I liked, because Gravity was, but this is fun. This is a fun movie. It's a fun movie to watch. Thumbs up for The Martian.
since I have my clipboard out, I'm just showing the podcast some of my artwork that just happens to be laying there.
Cool. I'm eating the apple.
I thought you finished the apple.
No, I just started the apple. I just ate the sticker that was on it.
And that is a movie we're going to have to cover one day. We're going to have to cover the apple.
Oh, yeah. Goddamn. The apple. One of these days, I want to do Sergeant Pepper's Lonely Hearts Club Band.
Yes. Okay. And I saw one on my video shelf. I don't know if we would want to do this as a feature or as homework, but if it's not on Netflix, it has to be on YouTube. Atomic Cafe.
Oh, I was obsessed with that movie for a while.
So was I. That is some.
I was absolutely obsessed with that. Like my kids know Bert the Turtle.
Yeah.
Duck
and cover.
Duck and cover. I actually downloaded an album that is nothing. The entire album is just remixes of Duck and Cover. So I've got like three songs on my phone that are just weird remakes of Duck and Cover. Like, here's one.
I've used Duck and Cover in a couple of things, and I can't remember what, though.
Then the beat hits. Maxwell's dancing. Come over here and dance, Maxwell, so you can be on the video. Yes, that's good ducking and covering. When the Russians finally send their nukes, then you guys are going to be safe. Hiding under a... I don't have any gum. I'm eating an apple. You can have an apple if you want. I love Duck and Cover. I'm a big fan of Duck and Cover is what I'm saying. I loved that movie. I love that movie. I just love... like propaganda. That's one of the main things. I'm a big fan of propaganda.
It's propaganda and I don't know, man. Just strange. Like they were the army LSD tests.
Yeah.
I mean, that's not exactly propaganda, you know, but it still has a really holy fuck quality.
Yeah.
Like you slipped LSD. All they knew was they were volunteering for something.
Yeah.
And then they slipped a lot of LSD into their food.
I also love the idea of, number one, back then it was just the idea of America is perfect. We must all strive to be normal.
Yes.
We are normal people. And I like that.
Uh-huh.
I also just like the fact that nowadays, I think most of America thinks, okay, well, what can the government do for me? But back then it was, what can you do for your government?
Yes.
In case of a nuclear war, here is what you must do to protect yourself. That is so different than the way we think now.
Well, at the same time, man, you know, war was not as easy as it is now.
Mm-hmm.
You know, World War II had a huge impact on the entire country, where life in America drastically changed for World War II. Women were working in munitions plants, you know, and you had to have victory gardens to grow your own food because the food was needed for the soldiers.
Yeah.
You know? And you couldn't really have rubber and you couldn't have nylon because these were just really precious commodities.
Yeah.
You know, so like when America went to war, all of America went to war in one way or the other.
Yeah.
Even if you did not physically go, you know, now it's really easy to say, let's send over a bunch of teenagers. Fuck it.
Yeah. Yeah.
And we are.
We have enough C&D students. We can win this war.
Yeah.
So, Santa Claus Conquers the Martians. I read a book recently about the making of Santa Claus Conquers the Martians. I'm not 100% certain as to the truth, the truthiness, the validity of this story. It's an autobiography written by a cast member in the movie. So, as with autobiographies, you know, sometimes you gotta take them with a grain of salt. So,
right.
I believe that most of this story here, of the making of the movie, Santa Claus Conquers the Martians, is pretty true. So, anyway, we're gonna be talking about Santa Claus Conquers the Martians. Let's go over some stats first, really quickly. The script for Santa Claus Conquers the Martians was written by a young Nelson Mandela.
Okay.
Based on an original theatrical play that was originally written by Sir Francis Bacon, whom everyone knows as the esteemed playwright, the inventor of bacon, and the father of Kevin.
Yes.
Bacon. The film was the directorial debut of St. Nicholas himself, Mr. Christopher J. Kringle.
Yes.
And the reason is, guy was just tired of people making movies about him and his life's work, but without his approval. In fact, up until Santa Claus Conquers the Martians, all the movies that were made about Santa Claus did not have his authorization. Miracle on 34th Street, unauthorized.
Mm-hmm.
He was just upset, you know? He wanted to tell his version of the story. And also, just, you know, like so many people on Earth, sure, Santa was like an omnipotent being with unlimited powers that never aged. But what he really wanted to do was direct.
Yes. Much like Potsy from Happy Days.
Yeah, yeah. Was that Donnie Most?
That was Anson Williams.
Oh, there you go. Yeah.
Donnie Most is, I believe, a transvestite hooker.
Most. Donnie Most.
I can't swear to that, but that's what I had heard.
Yeah. So Santa said that he made a deal with a film company, and he said that he was going to tell his story, the real story, and he also promised that it was going to be epic. Now, what you got to realize is that this movie was made in the 60s, 1964, you know, the swinging 60s. It was a different time.
Right.
Santa Claus at the time had a pretty big drug habit. From what I've heard, you know, he started smoking some reefers with the extras.
Uh-huh.
Grimar, blowjob, you know. And then he started getting into a bit of the cocaine, as Dewey Cox would say.
Yeah.
In fact, you know that scene in Scarface where he just has that whole desk full of cocaine?
Yes. Mm-hmm.
Santa Claus. That was based on Santa Claus. Large amount of Scarface is actually based on Santa Claus. In fact, the budget was originally enormous for its time. The budget for Santa Claus Conquers the Martians was rumored to be upwards of $200 million. Unfortunately, Santa Claus snorted most of the budget. A large amount of the budget also went to just extravagant gifts that Santa would give for no reason. Like Droppo,
uh-huh,
the laziest man on Mars. Santa bought him a solid gold pineapple slicer.
Ah.
Why would you need that? It just...
Oh, it's really practical.
Well, okay. Like,
Well, I saw your pictures of all the pineapples. Did I lose you?
But he got conned.
What?
Like the guy who played Voldar.
Yes.
The evil guy.
He was Santa, the porn mustache?
Him. Yeah.
Yeah.
Santa bought him a full-body wolf costume made of ostrich feathers.
Ah.
That's where a large portion of the budget went. But right
those are,
now...
Those are so warm, you know?
Yeah. To this day, Pia Zadora has in her house a diamond encrusted toilet filled with the tears of a dodo bird.
But that was really more of a payoff, actually.
Really?
Yeah.
Kind of like that Golden Globe thing. I didn't know about her and the Golden Globes until they kept referencing it on Mystery Science Theater. Apparently she was in some movie and it bombed terribly and she was horrible in it, but she won a Golden Globe for Best Actress. And apparently what had happened was that apparently her husband bought the Golden Globe people.
Yeah, probably.
And like bribed them so that she got this award, and it she wasn't nominated for any Oscars, but she was nominated for a shit ton of Razzies.
Yeah. That movie,
I didn't know anything about this until I was watching Mystery Science Theater and they kept mentioning Golden Globes. Like they mentioned her in the Golden Globes like two or three times. So I Googled Pia Zadora Golden Globes controversy. Got a whole story that I had no idea about.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That was Butterfly, right?
Yes. Yes, uh-huh. I believe so. Yeah.
Horrible movie, but she was so smoking hot.
Yeah. She
like it's a good movie to jerk off to. It serves a purpose.
Good to know. You know what else is a good movie to jerk off to? Santa Claus Conquers the Martians.
I wasn't gonna admit to that.
If you're into 50-year-old men dressed all in green.
Droppo had a nice ass.
That should be like the tagline for this episode. That's a good tagline. Now, when we're talking about Santa Claus Conquers the Martians, I feel that legally I should say that all of this allegedly happened because Santa Claus is pretty mum about this point, about this portion in his life. In fact, he's pretty much disavowed this movie entirely, doesn't talk about it at all. A lot of the people who are in the movie refuse to talk about it.
Well, like how Kevin Bacon will never talk about Friday the 13th.
Yeah, yeah. Uh-huh. In fact, the only real record of note about the filming of the movie comes from the best-selling autobiography Behind the Glow by Rudolph J. Reindeer.
Okay.
Rudolph says some pretty inflammatory stuff about Santa, about the making of this movie, about his rise and his fall when it comes to this movie. But the thing is, a lot of people kind of sort of think that book is BS, kind of like Chuck Barris.
Yes.
And his book, Confessions of a Dangerous Mind. Oh, I wasn't just a gong show host. I was also a spy.
CIA assassin.
CIA assassin. That's the ticket. Yeah.
I totally believe him.
Yeah, it's so believable. But
for just this reason, because who would ever believe Chuck Barris is a CIA assassin. Therefore, the perfect CIA assassin.
Gene the dancing machine would have believed it.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Anywho, the book got a huge mouthful of apple here. The book appears to be fairly accurate. Now, at the time, probably fueled by all the drugs he was doing, Santa Claus made some pretty bold statements to the press about his masterpiece.
Yeah.
Here are two quotes from him that I think perfectly encapsulates this point in his life. Ho, ho, ho! 500 million opening day, I promise. That was one quote. And then, of course, he got into a lot of trouble with this quote. Ladies, bring a change of panties. He really thought he was going to be like the next Burt Reynolds, but Burt Reynolds wasn't even a thing in 1964. He was going to be the first Burt Reynolds.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
But the thing is, I don't think that this story is particularly a new story. This is what happens when the talent gets full creative control. I feel like the same thing happened with Evan Almighty.
Yes, exactly.
You know how much that movie cost to make? $3.5 billion.
Yeah.
The director hired every animal on the planet to be in that movie.
And they had some hard-ass agents.
Yeah. Uh-huh. Like those
Especially
Cannonball movies.
Especially the Tsetse Fly.
Yeah.
The whole production was stalled for like a month arguing with the Tsetse Fly agent.
Because they can be real hard asses.
Oh, yeah.
Like those Cannonball Run movies. You know how those movies were made? They were made with a half a script and a truckload of cocaine.
Yes.
That's how both of those Cannonball Run movies were made. I'm pretty sure if you look closely, there's a credit in there for Cocaine Wrangler. Because that's the type of a movie that is. Why are you attacking me, Maxwell? Okay. I have no idea what you said, but go attack Bella. She's got a giant squid on her head. You should help her with that. So the premiere of Santa Claus Conquers the Martians, gala affair, red carpet, Santa Claus, you know, holding court.
Uh-huh.
All of the big 60s stars were there. Doris Day was there. Jack Lemmon was there. Jerry Lewis appeared in Nazi attire.
Uh-huh.
Got into a lot of controversy for that. They couldn't get the Grauman's Chinese Theater.
Right.
Or the premiere. But they got the next best thing. Grauman's Mexican-American Theater.
Uh-huh.
Which used to be in East L.A. before it was burned down and shot.
I thought I heard it was Big Bob's Beef and Brew.
Yeah, that might have happened recently. Yeah. So the movie bombed. It was laughed out of the theater. And I mean this literally. The movie was so bad that a riot happened. Doris Day cracked Jack Lemmon's head open with a solid gold pineapple slicer. Huge riot. 5 people dead. The only way that they could calm down the rioting audience was they stopped the movie and they just put on Goldfinger. And that calmed what became known as the Santa Claus Riot of 1964.
Yes.
So anyway, the film was so bad that it became a huge joke. And after that, people hated Santa Claus so much because of the movie that he made that they were like, you know what? Like, let's not even believe in him. Like, that's how bad this movie is. Santa Claus made such a bad movie. Let's just all pretend that he doesn't exist. And that has stayed pretty much to this day.
Yeah.
You know? In fact, I know that after the movie that Santa fell and had kind of like a dark period, but you know, I'm not entirely sure. Because basically the only bit of information that I have is from the book Behind the Globe by Rudolph J. Reindeer. I wasn't able to do too much investigating about this here tale. So I don't know the full story.
Right. I heard it differently.
Really?
Yeah. See, now I had an uncle that was very involved in the whole beat scene in later the 60s. You know, he was like the world's oldest love child and things like that. And he tells me that he was actually there. In fact, in the actual movie, he played the polar bear.
Oh.
So, he always told it to me as a story, so I kind of have to tell it in that same way. I'll try to jazz it up a little bit more. Where the fuck is page one? Okay. So anyway, one thing about Santa Claus that a lot of people don't know is that at the end of Christmas, when he returns back to the North Pole, he is really pretty bummed out. Okay, because he has a whole year ahead of him where he doesn't really have much to do. So this one year, he was hearing a lot about the beat poets and the whole beat movement and things like that. And he figured, you know, he's got the time. He would sit back and read a couple of the books. So that's basically what he did, hanging out at the North Pole. And he had gotten through On the Road and Dharma Bums and Junkies when he finally reached a point in Naked Lunch. And there was something that like clicked in his soul.
Yeah.
When he read the passages of the Black Meat. And he really didn't know what it was, but he decided that this was his path to true enlightenment. So Santa left and he went to the big city, where he started going from coffee house to coffee house, meeting other beatniks and, you know, making friends with them and,
like Walter Paisley.
Yes. Yes.
And nobody knows that Walter Paisley is born.
Exactly. And while he's doing this, you know, you go to one place, you have a cup of coffee, you go to another place, you have a cup of coffee, you know, but when Santa, being like a magical being, would drink coffee, he would get this complete manic delight and could actually be quite dangerous at times.
Really?
Yeah. But
I never knew.
But that is when he began writing. He would sit in the coffee houses. He completely withdrew from like all of his new friends. And he would just spend hours and hours just writing on yellow legal pads. Just different verses and poems and haiku. He kind of specialized in limerick for a while. And then after a while, he really needed to share this with other people. So he would actually get on stages for the open mics and had become addicted to the gleeful snapping of fingers that his poems and verse and things like that would attract. But then one day he is sitting down and he's writing and something clicks.
What?
And he realizes what he has to write. His greatest tale that he has never told before, of when he faced off with the Martians.
Ah.
And what triggered it is that he realized that the black meat was a metaphor for the Martians' black hearts and black souls.
Oh.
Santa hated himself. Some motherfucking Martians.
Yes.
He was not playing. I mean, you know, forget Muslims, okay?
Muslims.
Martians. Yeah. Martians were the threat to Santa Claus' very existence. And he worked feverishly at this, like a man possessed, filling up pad after pad of just everything he knew about the Martians. Until this one woman walks up to him and says, "To know the cat is to be
the cat."
And Santa looked up and said, "You understand." And she sat down and she said, "Yes. And if you were just to suck my toes, I would turn this into a film." So Santa grabs the pot of coffee on his table and holds the spout up to his lips and just guzzles that shit right back. And looks at her and says, "What is your name, little girl?" "I'm Noel." "And have you been naughty or nice?" And she says, "I thought you had a friggin' list. Now are you gonna suck my toes or what?" And Santa just said, "Let me get a couple of pots of coffee to go, and the toe sucking can begin." That's pretty much how this started. Now, the part in there is kind of a blur, and it may be some of the things that Rudolph alluded to in his book.
Okay. Gotcha. Okay. But
then we get to the set.
Yeah.
Of Santa Claus conquers the Martians, and there's, you know, just like a lot of hubbub. I mean, this was, I mean, granted, a lot of money was spent on drugs, but that was really for the cast and crew and not Santa himself.
Really?
The rest was really put into the production value of the film. So there were a lot of people on hand for this. In particular, there was Rigby, who was the first assistant director. And he had some problems with Santa, and really the only person you could not speak to Santa directly during any of this. So the only one who was really there for anybody to talk to try to get this production under some kind of control was Noel. And he would just complain to Noel all the time that Santa's just really getting out of hand. You know, but Noel was convinced that Santa was the greatest director who had ever lived and that this film was going to become a masterpiece. But Rigby was like, you know, we just can't keep up with his coffee demands. And she's like, you bring him anything he wants. This is art, you fucking Neanderthal. And he was like, but we're already bringing it to him in 55-gallon drums. You know, so there's definitely a problem with Santa on the set. But then when Santa would be on set, he was always looking at Noel and be like, where is that cute little Bea Zadora? I want to hear what she wants for Christmas. But Bea Zadora, after the first time Santa did this, spent most of her time locked in her trailer, sobbing uncontrollably, and nobody really knows why. Let's see here. Because I am adapting as I go along to try to make it a little more interesting for the podcast.
This is quite an interesting story. I'm learning a lot.
Yes.
You know, I'm filling up some of the holes that I wasn't able to fill before.
Yes, exactly.
A lot of hole filling.
So basically, there was a lot of friction on the set during this movie, and it was mostly caused by Santa's coffee addiction and, well, child molestation, but we don't know that for a fact. That's alleged child molestation. But one day Noel gets just fed up with it and slaps Santa right across the face, and it was like, you get your mind right, Kringle. You're creating a surrealistic experience of both nightmare and joy that challenges the work of Dolly. This masterpiece will go down in film history, but only if you keep your figgy pudding out of other people's stockings and your candy cane pointed at the goal. Okay. And that kind of drove Santa, you know, deeper into the coffee pot.
Right.
You know, and she tried, man. She slapped the coffee right out of his hand. It's like, you better get your mind right. Okay. You quit this shit. Dewey, you want no part of this. Okay. That's page one again. So that's done. I don't need that one anymore. Where is three?
I find this story to be absolutely fascinating.
Okay. So then we fast forward through there. Okay, that's, you know, because really my uncle was just the polar bear, so he wasn't on set like all the time. He was on set more than he ever needed to be because, well, there was free cocaine, you know.
Gotcha. So
then we flash forward to the premiere, because being part of the cast, my uncle had gone to the premiere. So Santa gets out of a limo and flashbulbs are going all off. Paparazzi are all around. And, you know, Santa's just hanging back and trying to fight back flashbacks from the Korean War. And was finally able to calm himself down when Noel got out of the limo and took his arm and they started walking up the red carpet. But even then, Santa was taking nips of coffee out of a flask that he had brought with him. But it was a great time for Santa. Everybody was just cheering, Santa, Santa, Santa. You know, people were, you know, it's kind of been erased from history because of the backlash Santa got. But the opening of Santa Claus Conquers the Martians was bigger than what we're expecting out of the opening of The Force Awakens. So this was the premiere. So people in the audience were going just absolutely fucking ape shit, you know, but Santa hustles in and they're kicking back in their theater seats. And, you know, they're already watching the movie and Santa's picking out bits of popcorn from his beard and eating it. Noel decides to give him like a little treat. So she gives him a thermos full of coffee and he starts sucking that back while watching it. And everybody seems like they're kind of having a good time, at least as far as Santa was concerned. Until just very slowly, somewhere in the audience, somebody booed. And then somewhere else in the audience, somebody else booed. And then somebody heckled and somebody yelled so that this, like, had a swelling like a wave that came across the audience, you know, of just a building hatred for the movie. Somehow people had turned and they had turned on Santa and started yelling, you know, "You suck, Santa. Fuck you, Kringle. What the fuck have you done with this? You've spoiled my childhood." You know, all of this.
Harsh.
You know,
harsh
and
stuff.
And Santa and Noel, they get up out of their chairs and they're trying to like kind of casually get out of the theater. Until one guy had ripped out one of the theater seats and lobbed it at Santa. And then everybody started throwing shit and it got into a really bad time. So Santa and Noel had to start running for the doors. And when they finally made it through the doors, that's when they heard the first of the gunshots.
Jesus.
You know, so gunfire breaks out and Noel is like, we got to get the hell out of here. And she starts running down the street. And Santa is like almost in a state of shock. And he looks back through the theater doors to see what's going on. And that's where he sees that everybody in the theaters are literally ripping each other apart and eating each other's flesh. And,
wow.
You know, Santa is like, oh, well, you know, I don't know what to do about this. So Santa started running and just turned out that he wound up running in a completely different direction than Noel. Now, for some reason, probably because my uncle drank a lot, this next part he told me in montage.
Montage, okay.
Yes, because you're going to have a montage. You got to have a montage.
Gotcha.
So scene one, we have Santa sneaking up on a Salvation Army volunteer.
Okay.
Clubbing him over the head and running away with his bucket and bell. Okay.
Okay.
And then we have another shot of Santa. He has set up the money pot and he's ringing the bell in front of a coffee shop. And there are just literally cups like knee deep all around Santa.
Okay. Really?
Yeah.
Okay.
Because, you know, none of that money was really going to the Salvation Army. Then there's another shot where he had set up outside of a Howard Johnson's and one of the customers comes out and he's just like, "It's May, you fat bastard." You know, I mean, and then Santa has his hands on the hood of a police car and he's getting pat down. And then we see another shot of Santa getting mug shots and we fade out 'cause you always fade out at the end of a montage.
Exactly.
So we cut to, you know, some period later, because it seems like more time has passed when you fade out. Yeah. Santa is stumbling down the dark city streets. He got his Santa Claus outfit back, of course, you know, because they keep that property safe. But at this point, it's just torn to shit, and it's dirty and greasy and all kinds of unmentionable things. And he's walking down the street, and he's passing by this alley, and there's a guy standing right at the opening of the alley, and he's like, "Hey, buddy, I got something that'll fix you up." And Santa looks, and the guy holds out a thermos, and he says, "Espresso." So Santa reaches out for the thermos, and his hands are all trembling, and you know he's feeling the craving rise, and like, you know, we don't know how long he's been in jail. I mean, even if it's a misdemeanor, that's going to be at least a year without his coffee. You know,
yeah.
Because in prison you don't want coffee that somebody smuggled in their ass.
You know, exactly.
It's just not a good idea. But then, of course, the guy pulls it back and he's like, "You got any money?" And Santa's like, "No." And then the guy's like, "How bad do you want it?"
And
Santa's like, "I would kill for it." And he's like, "I wouldn't go that far." So he takes Santa down the alley. And he takes his cock out.
Like you do.
Like you do. And Santa dropped to his knees and just said, "How did it ever come to this?"
I had no idea that Santa fell so far.
Yeah.
Wow. This is just shocking and sad.
And then he just started gobbling cock right there. And just, you know, he needed his coffee.
He needed his coffee.
Yeah. And then we go just a little further, and Santa's passed out in an alley, and there's like all cum in his beard, and he's just covered in piss, and he's completely passed out, but he starts waking up as he realizes that somebody's kicking him. And he looks up. Are you still there?
Yeah, I'm still here.
Okay, I'm hearing something.
Got me? Okay.
It's something that sounded like maybe we were disconnecting or some shit.
Oh, okay.
He looks up and he sees it's Noel. And he's like, "How could you let it come? How did you let it get so bad, Kringle?" And he's like, "They were eating each other. They were eating each other."
They should make a movie about this, because this would be a good movie.
And then Noel hunches down and meets his eye and says, "You moved them, Chris. You affected their lives. That's what good art does."
True.
And he was like, "Are you sure?" And she takes her hand and cups his cummy cheek and says, "Of course, you old silly Billy." And Santa, you see Santa just starting to come to life again. And he looks at her and he says, "I've written another story." And Noel gets all excited. "Ooh, let me see. And he takes out a stack of papers. You still there? Because I definitely heard a disconnect sound there.
No, I'm still here.
Okay. He takes out a stack of papers, you know, just like shit that's written on napkins and bags and, you know, parking tickets, anything he could find to write on. And he hands it to her, and he looks at the and she looks at the cover sheet, and she's like, "Butterfly." Sounds interesting. Let's do it. And Santa's like, do you think we can get that cute little Pia Zadora? And she says, I think she's out of her trailer by now. And she helps Santa up out of the alley. And she says, I won't even make you suck my toes this time. And Santa says, actually, I didn't mind it so much. The end.
That's an amazing story. That's an amazing story. I was moved by that.
It's very touching in spots, yes.
Yeah, I liked that. Liked it a lot. Amazing that Santa could go through so much and still find a way to break into all of our houses every year.
Yes. Yes. Really, and try out for Major League Baseball.
Yeah.
You know, granted, he really didn't do very well at it, but damn it, he took that shot.
Yeah. It's kind of like a good rags to riches. Well, rags to rags story.
Yes.
Like that very much. Before we continue, maybe we should take a break. Should we take a break? I think we should take a break.
We should take a break.
We should take a break. All right. We will be right back with more of the Pope on Film after these commercial messages.
Our tale today is about a young
man. Hey, everybody. It's me, Dabney, the fucking alien.
Most of his time in the fields and woods.
And I'm here to give you this week's updated leaderboard. Leaderboard is for the yearly prize on the Pope on Film podcast, which is a $300 Visa gift card. So let's bring up that leaderboard. Remind everybody about last week's winners. While I sit here and just be really bored and...
Why, you poor thing. There you are.
Wait for that screen to come up and... I don't know. Think about my life and fucking wreck it is. Yeah. All right, that's last week's winners. So let's go ahead and cover it back up again.
You can use another path. Yeah. All you humans keep on walking over our village and breaking our...
I should have been a dancer.
Why, I'm sorry, Dan.
Yeah, that's what I should have done, but no, no.
And what's more, I'm
an alien or whatever. Okay.
Thank you, young man. We'll remember you.
So at number 10, we have Faith Michelle Thurman. With 6 entries.
Young to be trying your wings. Don't you think you should?
At number 9.
We would if we could. We were hungry and
Evgenie.
When night comes, we
Melodic. With 6 entries.
No,
dude, if you watch this, please tell me how to pronounce your name.
Hey.
At number 8.
Thank you.
Dylan Connolly. With 7 entries. At number 7, C.J. Hackett, with 9 entries. At number 6, Manic Mommy 7, with 10 entries. At number 5, Eric Ballou, with 11 entries.
What are the rules of the contest?
At number 4,
the king makes up
Brock Z. Davy with 18 entries. At number 3, Julie Davy with 22 entries. At number 2, Bruce Noble with 104 entries.
Yes, Your Majesty, that's my...
And at the number 1 spot, holding his lead, 9-volt DC with 421 entries. Good luck, everybody. You're really putting in the work. Thank you very much. Keep an eye on the Pope on Film. Find out how that leaderboard's going and who's winning our weekly drawings. Rock on with your badass selves.
Do you like comic books?
Me
too! Do you listen to podcasts?
Are you still talking to me?
Cool! I have one called The Comic Book Update.
So?
I do weekly reviews of story arcs, comic miniseries, ongoing titles, and more.
I don't care.
I know, right? So all you have to do is go to the website at comicbookupdate.com.
Why would I do that?
We post daily previews of new comic books every day.
Ugh. Someone save me.
And every weekend is Cosplay Sunday, with blog posts featuring cosplayers from around the world.
Excuse me, miss. Is this guy bothering you?
Back off, buddy. She's with me.
Yeah, I don't think so.
Sorry. Nerd rage.
Oh, yeah.
So check out The Comic Book Update at comicbookupdate.com, as well as on iTunes, and stream it live on Stitcher. The Comic Book Update, the antidote for nerd rage.
We are back with more of the Pope on Film. Now, here's some interesting stuff. I mean, obviously, okay, Pia Zadora was in this movie. Okay, yay. But there were some other people that were in this movie that I didn't fully know about. Like, I did a lot of IMDb-ing on this, and almost all of the people in this movie did nothing after making this movie. There were a few people who did a couple of like TV show appearances, but that was it. But there were some other people that were in this movie that was kind of surprising. For starters, the TV reporter right in the beginning of the movie, like I think his name is like Andy Andrews or something like that. He goes and visits Santa Claus in his workshop in the North Pole in the beginning right. of the movie. He was the doorman on the Jeffersons.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Did not know that. He was the door, the white, slightly pudgy doorman from the Jeffersons. And the Jeffersons was on for a long time, too.
Yeah.
That, it, no idea that he went on to do something else. And this I had no idea about. Droppo was Uncle Wally on Sesame Street from 1984 to 1992.
Wow.
Droppo was on Sesame Street for almost a goddamn decade, and I had no freaking clue. And he also had a part in the movie Steel Magnolias.
Okay.
I had no clue.
Who was the
Droppo?
Who was the lead Martian? Because he looked really fucking familiar.
Kemar. He did a bunch of TV shows, but that's about it.
Yeah.
Yeah. He didn't do anything of note. Although the mom, Momar, she was a nurse in that weird movie God Told Me To.
Yes, okay.
With Andy Kaufman going on a cop killing spree.
Yeah.
Yeah. She was in that movie. She only did three movies, but one of them was Santa Claus Conquers the Martians, and the other one was God Told Me To. So
that that was a strange movie. That was another Larry Cohen movie.
Yeah. Yeah. That was a weird one.
Which Larry Cohen, he's just one of those strange guys where, like, I don't know if I really like his movies, but I got to watch them.
Yeah. Yeah.
You know?
Especially God Told Me To. That was bizarre.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. But Q and the three It's Alive movies and the stuff. He did a lot of good shit. And he's still out there. He made a movie called Phone Booth a couple of years ago.
Oh, yeah.
With what the fuck is
the
his name?
Stuff. I love The Stuff.
The other guy from Minority Report. I forget his name.
I know who you're talking about.
Yeah. I can't think of his name right now. And he's gotten to be a name. Yeah, and it's kind of interesting because he's like a talent agent and he's really kind of crooked. And he has lost his cell phone, so he has to go to a payphone, and it's a phone booth. And
when he goes into the phone booth, he gets a call from somebody claiming to be a sniper in the building across from the booth.
Oh, yeah, I remember that movie.
Yeah.
Yeah, I remember that movie.
Yeah, that was also Larry Cohen.
Oh, well, that's cool. So he's still out there.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
That's awesome. Here is another interesting fact that I think a fact I find interesting about this movie, Santa Claus Conquers the Martians. In 2005, Penguin Putnam Publishing released a novelization of the film Santa Claus Conquers the Martians because the world was really clamoring for that, you know?
That sounds like a good business decision.
It was written by Lou Harry, and the guy's kind of like a staff writer for humor, for generic cheesy humor books. He wrote The Handbook of Excuses.
Yeah.
And The Encyclopedia of Guilty Pleasures and The Work Voodoo Kit. And, you know, tiny little, he's written a bajillion books, but they're all like tiny, small little, like $9.99 books that are designed to just make a quick buck and then be forgotten.
Yeah.
So his novelization also came with a DVD of the movie. Mm-hmm. Did you watch the Mystery Science Theater version?
I did, yes.
Good, because it's unwatchable otherwise. In fact, the actual movie is much, much longer. Which is, it's painful to watch without Mystery Science Theater. Yes. Like the Chochum scene just goes on and on and on. It is difficult to sit down for. Of course, the novelization of the movie is out of print now because of course it is.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Because nothing gold can stay, Pony Boy. It's like Icarus.
Uh-huh.
Not Icarus who flew too close to the sun, but the video game Kid Icarus from Nintendo, because that was fucking impossible. But there are used copies of the novelization all over the internet, all over the place. We had it at my work. I remember my manager, Lance, told me that I was being haunted by books about bad movies, because we got a lot of books about bad movies. We got the book 101 Movies You Should Die Before You See.
Nice.
And there was one that was just... It was just kind of like a picture book about cult movies, but it came with a DVD of Plan 9 from Outer Space and a couple of other movies like that where people were saying that these books were only coming in because I was working at the store. And I said no. And then, of course, that Christmas, we suddenly got in Santa Claus Conquers the Martians, the novel. But I tried reading it because I thought it was cute. I thought it was an interesting idea. But the book really rides on the Pia Zadora angle because it's told from her point of view.
Okay.
So it's written in a Valley Girl voice, and it's really fucking hard to read. Like, they made a really bad novel to go with a really bad book. They went out of their way to make this book bad, because it is. It's a really bad book.
Well, let's be realistic. How far out of their way did they have to go?
Yeah. Yeah. I love the Mystery Science Theater episode of this. It's one of my favorite episodes in terms of, you know, the cutscenes and the bumpers and Joel and the bots and stuff like that.
Yeah.
Like, we just watched El Santo Claus, and that was a Mike episode, but Joel just seems more honest.
The way I've always seen him is Joel was a little more, I mean, they both hold a kind of a center, okay?
Uh-huh.
But Joel is slightly more stoner, and Mike is slightly more jock.
Yeah, Mike tries a bit too hard.
Yeah.
It always seemed as if Joel had like this cool to him where he didn't have to try too hard.
Yeah.
But watching the Mystery Science Theater episode, it really hit me just how freaking old I am. This episode came out in 1991. There were still Montgomery Ward's Christmas catalogs.
Yes.
And there are no more Christmas catalogs. And when they're talking about the Christmas specials, they talk about Peanuts animated specials having commercials for Dolly Madison Foods.
Yes.
That's been so long since Peanuts were the face of Zingers and stuff.
Yes.
So long ago. And also, they referenced Donna Rice in this episode.
Uh-huh. Yeah.
That was Gary Hart in 1988.
Yes.
That was so long ago.
Presidential hopeful Gary Wright.
Yeah. And the thing that hurts the most is that they reference the actual movie TV special.
Can I get my dog?
The Fish That Saved Pittsburgh.
Okay, but if you don't mind, let us stop there for a moment.
Dr. J.
And consider, was it Gary White or Gary Wright? I'm kind of confused.
Who?
With Donna Rice.
Gary Hart.
Gary Hart. Okay.
That was Gary Hart.
Okay. So back in the 80s, okay, if you so much as got caught on a boat with an attractive woman, which is really all that happened there, you were out of the race for the president.
Yes.
Okay. And Howard Dean, remember Howard Dean from a few years ago?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. He got excited over a campaign. He got some good results, and he yelled, yippee. Out of the race.
Yep. Yep.
Now we can say we have to register all non-Christians. And that's okay.
Yeah. And that's fine.
What the fuck?
Well, it's because Donald Trump didn't say yippee after that.
Apparently.
You know what? On my
he
browser.
He can bang his daughter. And that's okay.
Apropos of absolutely nothing, I on my internet browser just now, I went to YouTube and I noticed that the advertisement that's on the side of my search results is in Spanish.
Okay.
So I'm wondering who's racist here. It's giving me an ad in Spanish because my internet knows enough to say, you are a Mexican. Here's an ad for you, Mexican.
Yeah.
Like, I don't know what por favor comparte tu donación lo ayuda a vivir means, but you're assuming I know that because I have a Mexican sounding name. Like, who's racist here? Is YouTube racist? Is my internet racist? Is this ad racist? Who's the racist person?
First, I would have to say that it means, is your uterus red and puffy?
That's what my uterus would mean.
But I would, we have to get down to who's responsible for this, and I think that would be Google.
Well, Google is racist.
I mean, I know that we either one of us, me or Jeannie, can't look up anything on Amazon without it popping up on Facebook.
But I never read anything in Spanish. I don't talk about my race too much on the internets.
Yeah.
Because I'm vaguely ashamed of the fact that I'm Mexican, but I'm a bad Mexican. So the fact that this Spanish language ad with Sofia Vergara on it is popping up just to me,
mm-hmm,
says something.
Yes.
I was really upset with Dish Network because they kept sending me ads for Dish and Espanol.
Really? Okay.
Yeah, in the mail. They would send me like once or twice a week. We would get some a letter in the mail to Esteban Galindo, and it was all in Spanish because they wanted me to sign up for Dish Latino.
Okay. Yeah.
It's like, you racist sons of bitches. God damn it. Seriously. Uh-huh. So let's talk a little bit about the characters.
Okay. I really shouldn't tell stories about my job, but
okay.
But I can't help this one. So I'm trying to help this woman with God knows whatever her problem was. And, you know, we take notes when people call in. So I'm looking back on the notes to try to pick up on whatever the history is. And I see that at one point we had sent a technician out for some kind of a problem. And she had called, after having made the appointment, she had called to let us know that her dog does not like dark-skinned people. So they have to send a Caucasian technician.
Nice. Nice.
I don't want to go into too many details because, again, I really shouldn't be telling stories like that, but come on.
That is phenomenal.
Yes.
usually about once a year, I will get someone, always a white person, come up to me at work and ask me to help them, but they immediately start speaking Spanish.
Yeah.
Because they see me and they assume that, oh, well, I will speak to this person in his native language and he will appreciate that. Maybe that's Google. Maybe that's also, that's exactly like this goddamn Google ad that's staring me in the face.
Mm-hmm.
Goddamn Sofia Vergara. She's not even showing her boobs in this ad.
Yeah. And if she's not, what's the point?
Exactly. So I wanted to talk a little bit about the characters, the Martian characters in this movie, because it can be difficult to wrap your head around these characters and their names and all that sort of stuff. So there's Kemar. He's the square-jawed Martian leader, vague hero of the film.
Mm-hmm.
And then there's, of course, Droppo. He's the laziest man on Mars.
Yes.
And then there's Momar. Momar is, of course, the Libyan revolutionary socialist leader who was in power from 1969 to 2011.
Yes.
And was responsible for a number of terrorist acts against the United States. And also Kemar's wife.
Yes.
Voldar is the
Momar
evil...
Momar really looked the part, too.
Yeah, yeah. Voldar is the evil mustachioed Martian with the porn stash.
Yes.
That's Voldar.
Oh, I got confused. I thought you were talking about him.
No, Momar.
Yeah.
Momar Gaddafi played Kemar's wife.
Uh-huh, okay.
Chochum, that's the elderly wise Martian.
Yes.
Who can barely talk and might be like half turtle.
Half turtle or possibly half Muppet, I was thinking.
Yes.
He had a very Muppet quality about him.
Yeah. Like a not just any Muppet, like a dark crystal Muppet.
Yes.
Uh-huh. Yeah.
A Skeksis.
Yeah. Gotta get specific in your Muppets here. And then there's Torg. That's the Martian robot.
Right.
And then there's some other characters, Ringworm, Blowjob, Radar, Diplo, Plato, Duplo. So I've got like a really short Cliff Notes version of the plot of this movie, but even my really small Cliff Notes version of the plot of this movie hurts. But basically, there are children on Mars that are unhappy, so a group of Martians go to Earth and abduct two white kids so that these kids can help them find Santa Claus and bring him back to Mars. Voldar gets pissed and tries to kill them.
by sending him into the unforgiving vacuum of space. But Santa Claus is too good for such trickery. Santa is taken to Mars and is taken to a Martian toy factory, but it's not the same because he's just pressing a button and there's no midget slaves to do his bidding. Or if Mexico is correct, dead children. Voldar shows up. He tries to sabotage the machine and he gets some followers too. He starts getting some followers to kind of like a, I don't know, like a Hydra or a Kylo Ren in the new Star Wars. And they go to steal Santa Claus, but they accidentally get Droppo dressed as Santa Claus. Wah, wah, wah. There's a big fight at the end where a guy with a death ray is defeated with ping pong balls, which of course would happen.
Yes.
Absolutely would happen. Now, the movie brings up a, what I think is an interesting idea. See, there's not a lot of conquering in this movie. Santa Claus isn't doing a lot of conquering of Martians. Santa wins over the Martians with like his charm and a bit of Christmas magic, but he's not conquering any in any way. So with your permission, Bunforth, may I suggest a remake?
A remake of Santa Claus. Okay.
Here's my pitch. Santa Claus is played by a very angry Jason Statham.
Okay. Okay,
and he's just, he just Vikings the shit out of the planet Mars. Just rape and pillage and the whole shebang. And he doesn't rest until Kemar's head is on a sharpened candy cane spear.
Yes.
And he truly conquers the people of Mars.
Yes.
Boom. The only thing, though, and Natasha brought this up, if it is a Jason Statham movie, the title will have to be just one word. Because that's Jason Statham. So I'm thinking just Conquers.
I was thinking maybe just Claws.
Ooh, that's good. That's really good. That's very good.
With like a semicolon after it.
Yeah, we'll have to go with
so
that.
So it could be a Christmas Santa Claus movie. It could be an action movie. It could be a courtroom drama.
Yeah, I like it.
Uh-huh.
I like it. So that's it for what I have. That is it for what I have for this movie. Boom.
That is it, what I have for this movie. I mean, it sucked.
It's horrible. It's horrible.
It's a bad, bad movie.
Even with, like we said, even with Joel and the bots, it's a pretty difficult movie to sit down and watch. And that's always a bad.
And everybody associated with this movie is going to burn in hell.
Yes, especially Pia Zadora because of the whole Golden Globes thing.
Yes.
Before we wrap this up and everything, should we take a break? Maybe we should take a break.
Let us take a break.
Yeah, let's take a break. We will be right back with more. Oh, Maxwell's already coming over here. We will be right back with more of the Pope on Film. After these. Hey, kids. Whoa, way to jump the gun on the. On the commercial music there, guys. We will be right back with... No, it's okay. We will be right back with more of the Pope on Film after these commercial messages.
Faye Ray. Janet Lee. Adrian King. Heather Langenkamp, Amy Steele, that weatherman who saw the cockroach,
oh my god,
Jamie Lee Curtis, and you, come on, you know you wanna, let her rip. There. Now don't you feel better? You are now officially a Scream Queen. Come play with the rest of us at www.screamqueens.com. That's Queens with a Z. Or you could subscribe to us on iTunes. Either way, it's gonna be fucking fabulous. The Scream Queens Horror Podcast. It's where horror gets bent.
And we are back with more of the Popon film. So, next week, we will be off.
Yes.
I'm going to try and record an episode of the podcast here at home, a short one, featuring the kids, Maxwell and Bella. Maybe, Emerald, Bella, you're going to have your own episode of the podcast. Yay! You guys can talk about whatever you want. I'm hoping that you guys will talk about famous German philosophers. Is what I'm hoping you'll talk about. Maxwell, you want to talk about famous German philosophers?
Yeah.
Really? Yeah, who's your favorite German philosopher?
You.
I am a huge German philosopher, yes. I am very big in Germany.
But here's what you can do.
If you do
a couple of really short podcasts and pair the kids off, okay? Maxwell and Bella, Maxwell and Emerald, Emerald and Maxwell, you know, like this, and call it Generational Death Match.
Nice.
Uh-huh.
That would be good. I'll see what I can do.
Yeah.
I was thinking, you know, since we'll have like two weeks until our next episode, I was trying to think of a movie that is big enough that it would benefit from the lengthy amount of time. So I was thinking maybe if you would like to spend this time to finally do Kill Bill Volumes 1 and 2.
We could do that, yeah.
Awesome.
I want to do Kill 2.
That would be a nice departure from Santa Claus.
Yes.
And all the Christmas.
And also, it'll just be nice to do a movie that's just really, really good.
A lot of pressurized Japanese.
Yeah.
I always like that.
Yeah. So that's going to be good.
And we also have to start thinking and working on our year-end wrap-up.
Oh, yes. A year-end wrap-up.
So we'll take a week off. I know you have, like, a lot of family obligations and things like that. I have fallen behind a lot and a lot of things I need to do. You know, like I have a whole lot of bobs that are sitting on my hard drive that I just have to finish up and get out there. But I've been having a really hard time getting around to it. You know, and we are supposed to be cross-promoting on OSI, but I haven't gotten that promo done yet, you know? So that'll give me a week to catch up on a lot of stuff, too. So we both need this.
Well, that'll be good.
Yeah.
This'll be a good time. And also, you know, I don't know when the last time was that we just missed an episode or whatever. So it'll be nice.
It's been a while.
It has. We've been on a roll. So it'll be nice to have like a little break or whatever.
Yeah.
So I'm excited for it.
But we do have a contest this week.
Yay! And contest!
Since we missed last week, we will draw two names.
Ooh, yes.
And because we skipped a week, we have a fuckload of entries.
Awesome.
And I can actually show the hat to our audience to see all the names in the hat and how these slips of paper are prepared. And I am shaking the hat and Jeannie is reaching in.
I'm reaching in. Oh, it's 9-volt DC.
9-volt DC!
Yay!
Okay, draw another for the second chance button.
That's It's Bruce Noble.
Yay!
Yay!
Not
another one. What?
For his second chance.
All righty.
Very nice. Good job, gentlemen.
It's Jeff O'Brien.
Woo-hoo! Yay! So Jeff O'Brien is our first winner, and now we have to do it again.
We're gonna do it again.
Okay, so go ahead.
Dig it in the hat, and it is Richard Corso.
Yay!
Yay! Good stuff.
Okay. So I will be contacting you gentlemen sometime as soon as I can and get your information and get those out for you.
Sweet. Very good. Good stuff. Good contest. Good episode. Not the best movie, but we made it good.
We made it through the rain.
We did.
And found ourselves something. Oh, fuck. I'm having a Manilow flashback. Oh, no! And you came without taking.
Sorry.
I sent you away. Oh, Mandy! Ah! The horror. The horror.
I bring out the Manilow in people.
My dog is looking at me very sympathetically right now. What's wrong?
Aww.
Maxwell, shush.
It's cool, kids. It's cool. The kids are all here because they know that I'm wrapping up, so they're really excited to say their catchphrases.
All right. So until next week, I am Bunny Williams.
And I am Reverend Steve. Thanks for listening, guys. And we will see you next week, you godless heathens.
And you poopy tits, you douche waffles.
Come on. Not too long ago, I was quite the professional. My friends and I, we were the creme de la creme in an exclusive industry. And we all worked for this man, Bill. Then one day, I decided to leave, settle down, and start a new life. But when I tried to get out, they did me in.
Don't you ever wake up.
I guess they should have tried a little harder.
So I suppose it's a little late for an apology, huh?
You suppose correctly.
Now it's kill or be killed.
You have every right to want to get even.
Get even?
Even, Stephen?
I would have to kill you. That'd be about square.
And I choose kill.
Mommy, I'm home.
Hey, baby. How was school?
One ticket to Tokyo, please. One way.
Batwoman deserves her revenge. And we deserve to die.
No kidding, I heard it was kind of hard.
Silly Caucasian girl likes to play with samurai swords.
Yeah. Oh. Any more subordinates for me to kill?
Hi.
Go home to your mother.
You didn't think it was going to be that easy, did you? For a second there?
Yeah, I kind of did.
Silly rabbit.
Hard part's over.